upgraded our wireless networks. Networks were going down too. I mean, the place was a mess. Our Cisco network was 12 years old. So I went to the chancellor's office, begged them to replace our network. We were on the list to be upgraded in 2016, according to their timetable. So I went and begged them. They upgraded us in 2014. Started moving services to the cloud. We moved Blackboard to the cloud. Blackboard was hosted in-house. Even though after the crash, they had put in a lot of systems in place, you know, we can't afford to go down anymore. So moved Blackboard to the cloud, moved email to the cloud, moving the website to the cloud, process improvement across the campus. All the paper-based processes were moving into workflow management system on base. And one of the things that the president said was, I need institutional intelligence. And when I went there, the institutional research team and ITS team had a lot of conflicts. The IT team said, institutional research, you don't need any data, you can't have access to the data, so we took all those barriers. So institutional research started cranking out reports. We created a 24/7 world-class technology support center. Actually, after hours, if you call, the calls are being now taken by Blackboard User Support Services. It's an outsourced service. They provide great service, and we put grants and initiatives in place. So student value, we signed up with HETS. I mean, HETS provides a lot of value, right, for our students. The Virtual Plaza, now they've added the career transition services. And really, when we started working with HETS, people were like, oh, one of the misconceptions people have is this is just for Hispanic students. And, you know, it's a misconception, right? All these services are available in English and Spanish. It's bilingual. So when the name HETS comes up, Hispanic Educational Technology Services, the non-Hispanic students are like, oh, this is not a service for us. And that's one of the myths we're trying to overcome and say, look at all these services that don't look at the name of the organization, but look at the services that they provide, the career transition, the testing, the GMAT, and the TOEFL. All these services are just great values. Microsoft Office, MVC Learn, Mathematica. And one of the interesting things that we did was we had download parties. And this is something you should try in your institution if you haven't done it. So what the download party is that we invite students and say, bring your laptops and we'll help you download all the free software that we offer, and we give them pizza. So pizza works great with students. So students, the first time we did it in 2014, last year, or the year before, we ordered maybe 50 pizzas. It was gone within half an hour. Students were coming. One group of students will come, they will eat their pizza, download the software, they leave, another group will come, and by the time we were sent done, we had ordered more boxes of pizza. So this time we ordered like 150 boxes of pizza. Very, very popular. Students, you know, you send emails to students and you communicate to them, they will never do this, right? But you invite them and have pizza and downloads and we play music.
What is some examples of the kinds of software you're...
Microsoft Office.
Okay.
You know that, right?
Yes,
it's free
yes.
for all students.
Yes,
Mathematica.
Yes.
While they're downloading, we show them HETS. We show them NBC.
Okay.
All these kinds of things. We have different presentations going on because they're sitting there, the software is downloading, music is playing, and I have different subject matter experts come and talk to them about the different services that they provide. So they're eating their pizza, they're downloading, and they're getting all this information fed to them. And we give them a flyer with all the things that we talked about. So Microsoft heard about our download party, and they actually showed up in one of our download parties. They wanted to sponsor the pizzas. So that means it's a really good idea. It's very cheap. You know, pizza is cheap, right? And then we have students sitting on all committees. As I mentioned, IT governance has the student government ASI president sitting on it. And any hiring committee, whether I hire a technician or a director, any of my IT governance subcommittees, students are there. So we basically, there are two major constituents of students and faculty and of course staff. So we involve students. this is where the instructor design. After a year I've been there, the president said, I'm going to have academic technologies report to your office. So it was under the provost's office, so it moved under my office. We had a change in leadership for academic technology. I and my team hired a director of academic technology services. We hired new instructional designers. Still, the perception was, oh, you guys are techs. What do you know about teaching and learning? So this year, we hired a full-time faculty to serve as a faculty associate for the academic technologies division. So this is already a tenured faculty member. We block our time out. Do you have time buyouts in your institutions? Faculty buyouts. So you can actually hire a full-time faculty, buy them out of the classroom. And we can do that very, very cost-effectively in California. So full-time faculty member, we went through an interview process. It was a faculty-led interview process. They selected this full-time faculty member, and now things are starting to change because now all of a sudden it's one of them sitting with us and promoting instructional technology. We hired 3 new instructional designers. We had 3, now we have 6. We have hired somebody called an instructional technologist. The difference, of course, an instructional technologist is a guy who serves all the software and hardware needs of the faculty members. It's quite different from the instructional designers who help with the instructional design. But the classroom, the instructional technologist helps the faculty members experiment with different kinds of software and provide them assistance on the software side, non-instructional side. And then we started doing this incubator classroom. So I don't know if you can see this picture. These incubator classrooms are so cool. We have all kinds of chairs and all colors. Do you have any classrooms like this yet? It's like a classroom like this. We took it and we started putting comfortable chairs, couches. So it's all over the place. It's almost like a lounge.
Okay, this is the concept that in my world in the library, we are currently calling learning pods.
Yeah.
A similar
concept, but this is within the confines of a classroom. We take a classroom and convert it into a little commons area. So students are sitting all over the place. They choose the furniture they want to sit in, and we have screens all across the room. So regardless of whether you're facing the faculty member or not, you can see a screen, and the faculty has a moving podium. They can go and stand in the center. Everything is flexible. They can have students work in groups. They can have a traditional classroom, anything that they want. Now, we did 2 classrooms. We did 1 incubator classroom in the basement of the library, and then a kinesiology lab. So the incubator classroom concept is that we invite faculty to teach in an incubator classroom, and it's got all kinds of technologies, with the understanding that this is not proven technology. We will put new technology in there whenever it comes out. But if you're willing to experiment with it and willing to take failures sometimes of the technology, then you are a brave person, you can teach in this classroom. But the kinesiology lab is established. Once it's established in the incubator classroom, then we move it to the regular classroom. Once we know that the technology works, it's reliable, then we move it to. So we have now a Taco Bell model. You know how fast it takes for them to build Taco Bell these days, right? It's about 2 months. Taco Bell coming. Next thing you know, there's a drive-thru and you're ordering your tacos. Taco Bell has done it so efficiently that they take a footprint, they just replicate it. So we experimented with it in the incubator classroom, and we have now established 4 classrooms across. We just started last year. And so there's 3 components to it: furniture component, AV component, and computers. Some classrooms don't have all computers, some classrooms are computer labs. And all classrooms have AV. So I took a dean to look at one of those classrooms, and she asked me, how much does it cost you to convert this classroom? So I said, $45,000 for the furniture, $65,000 for the AV equipment, because we have screens all over, and then about $60,000 for the computers. 40 computers, the card, chart, laptop. 25K, you change the teaching model, the experience of the students, without even touching the technology. Now, if you want to go all out and do the technology, it's going to cost you another 65 plus the computers, another $60,000. But many deans are now saying, I'm just going to do the furniture. I'm taking out all these outdated chairs that face the professor. Or, of course, professors always, you know, they modify the class, but these don't have casters, wheels, and stuff, right? So it's awkward to break them apart, put them back. And these tables, there are tables. These tables are all actually mobile tables. This is not really a round table. This is two half rounds. So you can move the tables around. You can make a table like this. You can make any configuration that you want. So that's the kind of thing that's going on right now. And then we have an idea lab for the faculty, where faculty can come and experiment with any software, any kind of hardware that they want. It's like their playroom. No restrictions. Don't worry about accessibility. Don't worry about security. You know how it is, right, in big institutions. Oh, you can't bring that software because maybe it's got a virus or whatever. This idea lab is for faculty to come in and pretty much experiment with anything without any encumbrances. Once they like the software, then they take it mainstream, then we go through all this accessibility and security and all of that. So then I along with the faculty associate attend all the department meetings once a quarter and really talk to them about all the services that we provide. We attend all the faculty meetings. So it's really going out into the university and selling yourself as a value-added service. Information technology services was always viewed as this group of guys who always put roadblocks. ITS always said,